be horrible outside, but it's okay because today's guest will light up any room she walks into. She is one of television's most loved faces, here to tell us about her new radio show, BBC, on BBC Radio 5.5, and a whole lot more. Please welcome, all the way from the Emerald Isle, it's Laura Whitmore! Woo, woo,
woo, woo. Hello.
Well, you know, we try. I'm very well. How are you?
Yeah, not too bad. How's everyone? Good?
Yes, good. Excited.
Yay,
now, before we get into it, if you guys want to get involved at home and ask Laura a question, you can tweet us at BillSeriesLDN or leave a comment below this video if you're watching live on Facebook.
I feel like my mom might say, put a question up there and be like, can you call me back soon, please? Because I haven't replied to her message. Sorry.
I know. Isn't that always the way, though? I think mums text so much and you can't get back to them, Mrs. Whitmore, all the time.
No, I will. I'll call you later, I promise.
So listen, how are you? How's things?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm great.
You're busy.
Busy. Today's been a bit of a busy one, running around in this glorious weather that's outside.
I know. We're just moaning about it. But like, you know, you can't win. This time last year, it was so hot.
I know. And also, I'm an Irish girl. I'm used to the rain. I kind of feel like I'm at home now, so it's nice.
So listen, your new radio show, it's the second series.
Yeah, we're back.
How are things going? So you're back, which means people have obviously loved it.
Yeah, well, the first series was kind of a one-off, and it's every Sunday, and it's a new format that they very kindly, the commissioner, allowed us to kind of play around with. And I'm a huge fan of music, always have been from my MTV days, so I kind of wanted to get as much new music on the radio and also a space for new artists who maybe are independent and not the regular playlists you normally get. So thankfully they gave us a second series and gave us a few other episodes as well, a few extra. It got a bit longer.
And I listened to last Sunday with Imelda May, Regan.
Yes.
Which was great. It's great that you get
had
to
a few
have
Irish
such,
heads on.
Of course, it wouldn't be you without a few Irish heads. It's great that you get such an in-depth chat with your guests. Like Imelda talked very frankly and very openly about her journey, didn't she?
Yeah, about being a mom in the music industry. And we had Kelly Jones on talking about doing the school run. Kelly Jones from Stereophonics. We've got Noel Gallagher coming up. Rose McGowan. Who else? Freddie Flintoff, and just lovely to have a chat about other things, not just the things you normally talk about. So I'm a talker. I love asking questions. I love storytelling. So it's been quite a journey, as they say.
So you've had an incredible career since you started off all those years ago, back in 2000.
We worked together.
We have.
Can we talk about what we did?
A long, long time ago. A long time ago. But it was an ITV2 show.
Yeah.
Tell us what it was.
We pranked the band, you know, the band Blue.
Yes, it was called Blue Go Mad in Ibiza. And Laura was the host.
I was basically the Ashton Kutcher of it, because the whole thing was a setup.
A setup. So we brought the band Blue out to Ibiza and they thought they were running a bar for the summer. But in actual fact, we were pranking them.
Everyone was an actor.
It was incredible. So they had no idea.
But it was that bit where no one, we all knew what was going on, but the band didn't, and they thought they'd been arrested.
So basically, they thought they'd been arrested. We were driving them around the hills of Ibiza.
They were crying. Like it was full on.
And then we literally opened the doors of the van and dumped them out onto a studio setup in front of a swimming pool with Laura and the whole family. It was
saying surprise, and they were like,
"Your whole summer was a complete setup."
Great show. We had great fun.
We did. Now, but do you know what? I completely forgot about that until you told me about that. But your career has been, it's been incredible since you won Pick Me MTV back in 2000 and...
Oh,
it was 2008.
It was 11 years ago, 2008.
Yeah, 2008.
Yeah.
So you've gone on to, you presented I'm a Celebrity, Get Me Out Here Now.
Longest title of a show ever.
Yes, you've done the BAFTAs. Yeah. You were an announcer at the Eurovision. You've had a great career and now you're doing radio.
Yeah.
How do you compare both of them?
Radio, I started out in radio as a researcher on a network at home called News Talk.
I also worked.
And lots in common. So I used to be in a newsroom and my job was kind of looking after the court cases or if there'd been an accident, trying to find out what had happened. And I found that quite full on. I have a journalistic background and I love storytelling. I love talking to people and asking questions, but I found the newsroom really tough because you'll know most news is bad news.
Yeah.
And I found that quite tough and I struggled with it. And in the newsroom, I also met a friend of mine, Samantha Barry, who's now gone on to be the editor-in-chief of Glamour US.
Yeah.
So we both worked on the same show. And during my time there, I saw that MTV were doing this competition for the face of MTV Europe, and I thought that would be nice. So maybe I'll get a contact for some work experience, and I sent in a terrible showreel.
Oh, did you?
It wasn't even a showreel.
And here's a clip for now.
Oh, stop it. I think they burnt it. And yeah, I ended up winning the year's contract and moved to London for a year, and it's been 11.
It's been 11, and you're going strong. Do you prefer radio or TV? Do you prefer standing in front of a camera, or do you like the comfort of a radio mic?
I like doing a bit of everything. Radio is very homely, and I listen to a lot of radio, and it's quick. We made a little radio documentary last year called Losing My Religion. Yeah, yes. But I realised how quick the turnaround is. You know what TV is like. Everything takes a little bit longer. While with radio, you can have an idea and you can turn it around quickly. I also thought you don't have to worry about hair or makeup. And then
you
when I went
to the kettle on, you get your slippers on.
I thought the first day I went in working for BBC Five Live, I thought I don't have to worry about how I look. And then I realised they've got webcams.
Oh God, it's so annoying.
But I didn't realise the webcam was right there, and I was like really close, so it was really unflattering angle. So from then on, I'm a little bit wary of those webcams.
And because on your show last Sunday, you had an hour's sleep and you went on air.
Oh yeah.
How on earth did you get through that show?
I was very honoured to be part of the Life Ball, which is a huge event that happens in Vienna. And I was invited to that, which is a huge fundraiser for LGBTQ. Yeah. And it was just an incredible experience to get there. And I was supposed to be on a flight at 11 p.m. from Bratislava to get back to London. And I may have not made that flight. So I got
so
a 6 a.m. flight
try to
instead.
Make that flight?
I didn't even try.
No, because you're like, this is way too much fun.
This is way too much fun. But I didn't tell my producer I didn't sleep until on air.
Oh, my God. So you booked it. So did you make it just in time for the show?
I was there enough time to kind of go through some prep.
Okay.
I'm very professional, Simon.
Yes, you are. So, as you said, you are
someone's
a huge music
like
fan. You're a huge music fan, and you're doing an online music show called This Feeling with Gordon Smart.
Yeah.
What can you tell us about that? That's happening throughout the course of this year, is it?
Yeah, it's happening throughout the whole summer, and we've recorded an episode already. And again, this goes back to my love of live music. And when I first moved to London, I moved to Camden, to North London, and there's a huge music community there. And I've got to interview everyone over the years, like, you know, huge stars. But I love also being a huge supporter of new music. So that show really gets to the heart of that. I mean, we've got huge artists on it, and then we've got up and coming who are about to break it. So I love it.
And I saw a clip of you guys, now correct me if I'm wrong,
oh, no.
throwing washing machines out
oh, of
Oh
no, it was a television. What rock star throws a washing machine out a window? It's a television, it's a thing.
I know, but okay, right. So was that the guy?
No washing
machine.
They're old school TV.
Thing.
You see, the thing is with Simon, he's used to the flat screen televisions. So the fact that it was an old school one, can you imagine? Back in the day, all the rock stars, Mick Jagger, just trying to get rid of this washing machine.
Oh my God.
No, so we did a thing called the TV chuck to see how big a rock star you are by how far you could throw a TV out a window. And I think I came second to Miles Kane, so not too bad, actually.
Oh my God, well done.
Thanks. Something my mother can be proud of. I'll call you later.
We have to talk about your campaigning, because you know, you've got like a big platform. You've been in the industry for a long time and lots of people know you, and you use your voice for good, which is a great thing. You recently spoke out about the abortion laws in Northern Ireland. Why is that so important to you?
I think for me, it probably started just with repealing the Eighth Amendment of the Republic of Ireland, which was repealed last year, just over a year ago now. And the support for that, as someone who hasn't lived in Ireland for 10, 11 years, and I wasn't able to use my vote, but I felt I had a voice. So maybe if I can use it to get a few people who don't normally vote to vote, including people in my family. And out of my own ignorance, I didn't really realise the difference between the laws in between
North and South.
North and South, and also the UK, because the UK, England, Wales and Scotland is very different to Northern Ireland.
Yeah.
And recently in the press, we can see what's happening in the US, and we feel like we're going back in time. And for me, I would never tell someone what they should do. I'm about choice. I think everyone deserves a choice over their own body. And it was so prevalent in the press about states like Georgia kind of going back in time and taking this right away from women. And a lot of people didn't realise closer to home in Northern Ireland, it's even worse.
It's, so
You can be imprisoned for going off and having abortion, whatever the reason may be. That could be for rape cases. We not everything is black and white in life, and I think we need to look at that. There's lots of grey areas. Yeah. And I wrote an article for Elle this week, Elle magazine, and they kindly published it. And even my mother, I've talked about my mum a lot, but she was like, I didn't know that was the law in Northern Ireland.
But you know what? A lot of people don't.
Including people in Northern Ireland.
And there's been a huge spotlight on Ireland in the last few years with the gay marriage referendum and also Repeal the Eighth. What would you like the outcome of this to be?
I think just the power of all of us. I sometimes get overwhelmed by everything when it comes to Brexit and so many things happening around us going, what can one little voice do? And every single one of us has a voice and we can use it. And you can see that with the campaigning of repealing the Eighth. Like a lot of that was done through social, through protests. And I would just think, write to your MP, and you might think that doesn't have power. It does. Talk about it. Communicate.
And sometimes it's about bridging that gap, isn't it, between politics and the average person on the ground.
Because it affects all of us. Sadly, it does affect all of us. And it trickles down. And, you may not want to read the news or look at a newspaper, but those decisions that are being made will affect you. Maybe it won't affect you. Maybe it will affect your daughter. Maybe it will affect your son. So I think all of us as individuals have a responsibility. Sounding really heavy, sorry.
No, but you're right. You're absolutely right. And of course, you also do a campaigning for the huge plastic problem that we have worldwide. What can we do to kind of, make sure that we are reducing the plastic pollution?
Just little things. And I feel like I don't want to be that person who is like having a go at someone all the time, because it's not about that. It's simple things. There are, think of the amount of people there are on this planet, the amount of people there are in the UK. If we just made one little change, if it's giving up the plastic straws, and I'm terrible for packaging. Even Christmas time, I love wrapping presents.
I know.
I love it. I love all the packaging.
But it's everywhere we go.
But
you can't even go into the supermarket and buy something that's not wrapped in plastic.
And I think we forget everything ends up somewhere. When we put something in the bin, and even as a kid, I put it in the bin, I put it outside, the bin man takes it away, sure, it just disappears.
Yeah.
And there's an incredible campaign called Plastic Patrol. Have a look at them online. And basically, they go around all over the world, particularly in the UK, through the canals. And the stuff that you find in the canals and how it affects the wildlife and the detrimental damage it's doing is just horrific.
Yeah.
And we just forget about it. Everything you have, everything you use has to go somewhere. So you don't have to be perfect. We were talking about this just the outside, because I try not to use plastic bottles too much. But sometimes you're just thirsty. And that's okay. It's just making those small changes that makes such a difference.
It's good to carry your coffee, your
keep cup.
What is it made of? What's it called?
Plastic?
Is it plastic? No, it's not plastic.
The keep cup.
Yes, the keep cup.
Oh, yeah, but it's just not single use plastic.
Oh, yes.
So the fact that you can
reusable.
Use it. Yeah, reusable.
You can hang on to it for years.
For years and years.
And also just do things like don't buy fruit that's comes in plastic packages.
No need for it.
We could talk about this for hours.
It's
those little things.
Little things. And just being informed. Yeah. Just those little things that I didn't think about beforehand, and I probably was not a terrible person, but I didn't think. And now I'm thinking a bit more and just questioning things. I think it's very important to question things in life.
And to be conscientious.
Be conscientious as best you can.
Now, listen, we need to talk about your acting. So you, you've always talked about how acting is a dream of yours. And you did a theatre play a while back with Shane Ritchie.
I did.
Which was amazing.
It was good. It was 6 months. It was a long old stint.
How was that? And are you looking to pursue more acting in the future?
Yeah, my favourite thing in the world is storytelling. I've always loved that. And my background, I studied journalism, but I also studied drama. And I used to do lots of plays when I was a kid. And I remember being quite shy. And my mom was told by the teacher, shockingly, that I wouldn't talk in class. I mean, now all I do
is shut me up.
So she sent me to drama lessons, and she said that was kind of the worst thing she did, because I came back with a hand on my hip and this new attitude. But it really helped me develop, and I always recommend anyone, even if you're not into drama, to do some sort of drama lessons or something, just because it really does help with the talk with the people.
I think as well, if you're a shy teenager, it's especially good. It's interesting that creative outlet to kind of bring your show.
And find your people. I remember going to university and not knowing anyone and joining the drama society and then just finding like-minded people. So it's been something I've always kind of had kind of on the side, just for fun. And then the play came up, and there's been a few other little bits. I did a little sitcom, small little part last year in Ireland with Amy Huberman.
Great.
Just in a small part in a Hulu series, which airs the end of July, called Four Weddings and a Funeral, that Mindy Kaling's involved with. And I wrote my first short film, because I love writing, and we filmed that at the beginning of the year, and that comes out at the end of the year. So
where will we be able to watch that?
I have to come back and tell you about that. Ooh, at the time, won't I?
Please do.
I'd love to.
Before we go, let's talk Strictly.
Yes.
Because Strictly is probably on every celebrity's bucket list.
I wanted to get onto TV so I would have a profile big enough to be asked to go on Strictly.
Well, you got there.
I did.
You got there. And I remember when you came down the stairs, and we're going to mention it again, you talked about your mother.
I always talk about it. She's like, stop talking about me. Stop it.
But I'm sure your mum was so proud. And it was also
She came along to the show a few times, but I think she found it too stressful.
Did she?
Yeah.
So how was the Strictly experience? I mean, obviously it is, it looks absolutely, it's amazing to be on, but it's
a production.
Hardcore, isn't it?
Oh, it's hardcore, and the hours are crazy. And actually, my friend from Strictly, I believe, is in the building.
Yeah, I was just going to say, are you guys, because you were the sixth person out, and you guys had to dance off against
I had to dance
other.
Off against Ore Aduba, who ended up winning the show. So I like to think, does that mean I came second?
So, but I was just wondering, am I going to have to, be the middle man? Like, are you guys friends? Or
oh, so good. Actually, I'm probably closer to Ori than anyone else from that year, because he's just a special guy. And, I mean, I loved everyone who was on that show, but Ori in particular, I really was rooting to win.
Nice man.
Because I had the dance-off against him. So I thought, if you're going to go out of that show, you might as well go up against the winner.
So listen, you've had an incredible career. You've done it all. Is there anything else that you would love to do? Any other shows that you would love to be part of?
I definitely realise I prefer hosting shows than being in the show.
Right.
So much. I remember going to Strictly and seeing the autocue with like Tess and Claudia going, I just want to read that. I don't want to dance. I just want to read the autocue. I much prefer doing that. But I love writing. So that's, between writing for Elle and HuffPost and Hot Press and then writing the short film, I really, really enjoy that.
Well,
so.
Listen, we cannot wait to see what you do next.
I mean,
come
God
back
knows.
And tell
Who
us
knows?
About your feature film when it comes out.
Yeah.
And good luck with the rest of Sunday session.
Yeah, it's on this Sunday, 11 a.m.
Plug.
Sorry.
It's been so nice to have you on the show.
Thank you.
Sadly, that's all we've got time for with Laura, but you can listen to Sunday Session with Laura on Sundays at 11 a.m. on BBC Radio 5 Live. We'll be back at 5:30 with the lovely Ore Aduba right here on the couch. But right now, though, give it up one more time for Laura Whitmore.